From traumatizing events to secret experiments by the U.S. government, today we look at 11 psychological experiments you won't believe actually happened. Number 11. Humanity tests. How far will you go when ordered to do something by an authority? That's what Stanley Milgram wanted to find out. In 1963, Milgram tested how far people would go to hurt another human being under ordinary circumstances when given orders to do so. One test subject was the teacher, and another person was the student. The teacher was to give the student an increasingly severe electric shock if the student made mistakes. The electric shock machine was clearly labeled with switches that indicated increasing voltages and that finally said, "Danger, severe shock," and XXX. Every time the student made a mistake, the authority, wearing a white lab coat, ordered the teacher to continue. The student was hidden in another room, but could clearly be heard to scream in pain. The screams were fake, no one was hurt, but the teacher didn't know this. The authority would order the teacher to continue even if the teacher hesitated. How far would you go? The results are surprising and some say reflective of human nature. 63% of the teachers continued to administer the shocks despite the agonizing screams until the screaming and begging ended and the student fell silent. Number 10. Nightshift. Psychiatrist Charles Hoffling took Stanley Milgram's obedience research one step further when he tested nurses who didn't suspect that they were part of a psychological experiment. In 1966, Hoffling arranged to have a fake doctor call the nurse's station on night shift and order them to administer an unapproved drug to a patient at twice the maximum dosage. The medicine was fake too, but the nurses didn't know that. The questionable experiment ran 22 times, and 21 out of 22 times, the nurse violated hospital policy by taking orders over the phone and administered the drug. The authority invested in the doctor was so strong, all but one of the nurses obeyed. Number 9. The loneliest number. Where would you prefer to be if you had a sudden illness or a terrible fall? On a lonely road with only scattered traffic, or a busy metropolitan boulevard? The bystander effect, also known as bystander apathy, informs us that the lonely road may be our best hope for survival. How can that be? In 1968, John Darley and Bib Latané demonstrated this effect in the laboratory after the murder of Kitty Genovese in 1964. They performed a simple but profound social psychological experiment. They staged an emergency situation and timed how long it took people to intervene if they do so at all. The situations were variously staged with one, few, or many bystanders. The results showed that the more people are around, the more inhibited the response to the emergency, and by a large margin. When a person was alone with a fallen woman, 70% of the time, they would respond. Only 40% of the time would someone respond if there were many people around. Number 8. Tell the truth. How sure of yourself are you? How sure of yourself are you if you're the only one in the crowd with your viewpoint? Imagine attending a planned psychology experiment, along with 7 other people. You're all ushered into a room and handed 2 cards, one with a single vertical line printed on it, and one printed with 3 vertical lines of differing lengths. You're asked by the experimenter to choose which of the 3 lines matches the length of the line on the one-line card. All 7 of the other participants choose the wrong line. You know what the answer is. It's obvious. But you're the only one who sees it. Everyone else disagrees. What do you think? What do you do? In this case, in Solomon Asch's 1951 social psychology experiment, the other 7 participants were actually part of the experiment and told to pick the wrong line. Only one person was the subject of the investigation, and the purpose was to see if social pressure from a majority group could change behavior, forcing a person to conform. There were 18 stagings of the test, and in 12, the participants chose the wrong line. 32% of the subjects conformed. 75% of the subjects conformed to the majority at least once, and 25% never conformed. Overwhelmingly, the stated reason for conforming was that the subject didn't believe the participants were correct, but the subject went along so that they were not perceived as peculiar or ridiculed for their answer. It seems that people just want to fit in. Number 7. Guard your sanity. It was August 14th through 20th, 1971 at Stanford University in a 35-foot walled-off section of the basement of Jordan Hall. 24 middle-class, psychologically stable, healthy white males specifically chosen to have clean criminal records were selected and agreed to participate in a psychology experiment testing whether the inherent personality traits of guards and prisoners were the chief cause of abusive behaviors in prisons. They would be in the experiment for 7 to 14 days, each receiving $15 a day. That was how it started. 12 prisoners, 12 guards. Psychology professor Philip Zimbardo, who ran the experiment, performed the function of the superintendent. Zimbardo's goal was to induce de-individualization, disorientation, and depersonalization into the 24 men. On the second day, the prisoners revolted. The guards attacked the prisoners with fire extinguishers and without staff supervision. The guards felt they were at a disadvantage, so they began to use psychological tactics against the prisoners, such as administering rewards and punishments. Within 36 hours, one prisoner began acting crazy and had to be released. Soon, the guards started using physical punishments and refusing sanitary cleanliness. Forced nudity was initiated as a penalty. Cruelty escalated. Fully one-third of the guards exhibited authentic sadistic behavior. The whole thing terminated after only 6 days. More than 50 people observed the experiment. Only one questioned its morality. So, was it the internal characteristics of the participants or the situation they were in that caused the utter breakdown? What do you think? Number 6. Little Albert. At 9 months old, little Albert was a normal child, subject to an experiment of Watson and Rayner in 1920. At first, little Albert was given a soft white rat to play with, a white rabbit, a monkey, and various masks and toys. Little Albert was unafraid and played happily alone. In subsequent sessions, while he was playing nicely, a steel bar was struck loudly with a hammer behind his head. Frightened, little Albert would burst into tears. Whenever the steel bar was hammered, little Albert would become afraid. He soon grew anxious and feared his sessions. 2 months later, he was presented with a white rat, and within a moment, the steel bar was struck. Each weekly session, for 7 weeks, the same thing happened until just the sight of the white rat caused little Albert to cry horribly. Even if the steel bar had not been struck, he would quickly move away from the rat. In later sessions, little Albert started shying away from anything white and furry, such as the white rabbit, then the furry monkey. He even developed a phobia around a Father Christmas mask with a full beard. The story almost ends there because little Albert was taken away from these men. He was not deconditioned. He was not healed. It was thought that little Albert was better off without those men around him. It is now known that little Albert was in real life Douglas Merritt, and his mother was a wet nurse at the campus hospital. She was paid $1 for little Albert's participation in the experiment. Douglas Merritt died at the age of 6 of acquired hydrocephalus, and his mental state was unknown. Number 5. Eyes Wide Shut. How good are you at observing your surroundings? Are you like Sherlock Holmes, or more like Homer Simpson? The answer may disappoint you. In Orlando, Florida, in 2008, local news television Channel 6 set up a social experiment of their own. They printed up a missing child poster, but the child wasn't missing. It was a picture of 8-year-old, alleged, Brittany Begonia. Channel 6 posted the poster on the front window of a grocery store and had Brittany sit only a few feet from it. Hundreds of people passed by. They passed by the poster and looked at it. They passed by Brittany and looked at her. They said nothing. Only 2 people out of those hundreds reacted to the poster and did something about it. When asked about it afterward, the most common reaction as to why nothing was said or done was that they didn't want to get involved. Oh, they noticed all right, sure, but they weren't comfortable being part of the whole thing. Sound believable? Number 4. Monsters. In 1939, 22 orphan children were subjected to what has become known as the Monster Study. At the University of Iowa in Davenport, Wendell Johnson supervised graduate student Mary Tudor in an experiment that horrified Johnson's peers when they found out about it. It was nicknamed the Monster Study, presumably because that is how his peers felt about Johnson and his study. Half the orphan children were stutterers and received positive speech therapy. The other half were normal-speaking children and received negative speech therapy, punishing and shaming the children for any speech imperfection. As a result, those that began as normal-speaking children developed negative psychological problems, sometimes severe, and some acquired speech problems that remained with them for the rest of their lives. The Monster Study has produced the largest amount of scientific data available about stuttering and stutterers and showed the influence of a stutterer's thoughts and beliefs on their condition. Number 3. Less is more. Can you imagine wanting to be paid less to work a more boring job? That's one of the surprising psychological findings based on the concept of cognitive dissonance. Cognitive dissonance means that we find it difficult to hold two contradictory beliefs in our head at one time, so we unconsciously adjust one to fit the other better. In our boring job example, a study was done using students undertaking a boring task. They found the work more interesting if they were paid less, reasoning that if they didn't do it for the money, it must have some inherent interest within it. If this wasn't the case, they couldn't explain their behavior. This kind of rationalization goes on in our heads all the time. We don't even realize it. Unsettling, isn't it? Number 2. Fur Elise. Albany Medical College in New York researches what is hip with rats. What they came up with is that mostly, rats like the sound of silence. And if they're in a sober, relaxing mood, they like Beethoven. But if they're high on cocaine, they dig Miles Davis's jazz. The way it works is this. They tested non-drugged rats and let them listen to Miles Davis for. The scientists measured how active the rats were. Then half of them were drugged with meth and dosed with Davis again. The meth rats showed more activity than the unmedicated rats. The next experiment gave rats a choice between Beethoven's Fur Elise and Miles. Mostly, the rats chose neither artist and liked the quiet. Their second place choice, when the rats weren't drugged, was Beethoven. But after being amped up on cocaine, the rats listened to their least favorite choice, Miles Davis 4. This is a rat's brain on drugs. Number 1. Mind control. The CIA would control all of our minds if it could. We know this. In fact, it's tried at least once that we're aware of. In the 1950s and for the next 20 years, the CIA would use sleep deprivation, electric shock, hallucinogenic drugs, and other such brutal techniques to achieve mind control over human beings. This top-secret program was codenamed MKUltra. Its goal was to be able to brainwash victims at will. More than 149 research projects were carried out by CIA scientists through MKUltra. The scope of some of the tests was far-reaching. One project involved giving LSD to unwary bar patrons in New York and San Francisco to see what happened when hallucinogens were taken in social situations. Another project offered LSD to heroin addicts, with the reward of more heroin if they agreed to the LSD doses. Your government working for you.